Most of us think of the Old West as the stuff of myth and legend and cowboy movies. But the West was made by very real people. And people always leave stuff behind. So, if you're willing to get your hands a little dirty, like the archaeologist in this episode's profile, you might just discover the real story behind the myth, buried in the dirt and the sand.
We're just about there. And this just might be a little deeper. Yeah. Or perhaps might go down even on the...
Julie Schablitsky is an historical archaeologist with the University of Oregon.
Look, I'm a shot putter.
She's not afraid to get her hands dirty as she digs for the truth, literally.
Ooh, looks like an alcohol bottle.
Each archaeologist that goes out to a site is looking for a story.
It's a crown cap, though, so what's the middle mark? Is that CG together? I can date that here.
A story that will tell them something different about the people who used to live there.
What's the base of the bottle say? An S?
Something that hasn't been known before.
William Franzen and Son, 1900 to 1929.
Yeah, I saw that.
Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
So the Holy Grail isn't necessarily an object, it's a story.
Julie brings her passion for her science to what was once the site of a 19th century Chinatown in John Day, Oregon. That's where she's trying to tell the story of the thousands of Chinese laborers who came west in the late 1800s.
The Chinese were instrumental in building railroads. They were instrumental in mining. They made shoes. They were cobblers. They cut hair. They were servants in people's homes. They were cooks. Like all immigrant communities, you really build a country on their backs.
Yet, there are almost no written records from or about the Chinese of that era.
You don't see them documenting their life in journals, and very seldom do you find even letters that went back and forth between them and their families. So you have this gap of what it was like to be Chinese in 19th century America.
Oh, yep, it's a single dose medicine bottle. It's Chinese. Mm-hmm, Chinese, definitely Chinese.
And what archaeology can do is it can fill in those gaps and give the voiceless Chinese that voice.
Julie's love of archaeology started very early. Her first digs took place on the gravel driveway of her Minnesota home where she grew up. By the time she was 7, this self-assured second grader was telling her classmates she had found her life's calling.
Back then, when I thought about archaeology as being a lot of the gold idols with the ruby eyes and mummies and things from faraway land, and I never really realized that archaeology could be in your own backyard.
An idea that grew, along with her, through elementary school into high school. Even the poster on her bedroom door was of an atypical rock star.
Rameses II is not the average teen idol, but I found him quite interesting.
Today, her interests have gone beyond the idols and icons, and even the physical artifacts themselves.
You found a coin purse.
Oh my gosh, sure enough.
The bottle that you could pick up, the arrowhead that you could hold in your hand and think that, wow, someone made this. That's what really grabbed my interest. But what held it was that when I began to put those artifacts together and tell a story, that was really important.
And that's exactly what Julie helped to do on a headline-making excavation involving one of the great and gruesome stories of the Old West, the story of the Donner Party. The group of westbound pioneers who, because of bad luck, an ill-chosen route, and early snows, were trapped in the California mountains for a bitter winter in 1846-47.
So you had a little over 80 people stranded in the Sierra Nevadas in two different camps. In both camps, about half the people lived and about half the people died.
Just what the living did to survive horrified everyone who heard the story. Some survivors in the larger of the two Donner Party camps admitted they'd cannibalized the bodies of those who had already died.
It seemed that everyone was for sure that cannibalism was participated in by every single member of the Donner family party. I think a lot of people believe that they survived by eating each other.
Julie was the co-leader of a team that went back to the second camp to get a fuller story of what really happened there more than 150 years ago.
We want to know if they cannibalized. We want to know if they didn't cannibalize, how did they survive? How desperate did they become? What did they eat?
Julie's team discovered a buried hearth and a trove of burned and chop-marked bones. She took those bones and did what she's become known for, Julie brought in experts from other scientific disciplines. In this case, forensic bone analysts. Their findings? Those chopped, boiled bones were those of hunted deer and rabbit, of their horses, even dog, but no humans.
These people ate their family dog. They did everything in their power to extract every last nutrient before they did the unthinkable.
Thanks to Julie and her team, about half the Donner Party members at the second campsite were exonerated. Correcting the sensationalized stories of the entire Donner Party quickly resorting to cannibalism.
It looks like only several people did participate in cannibalism, and not till the very, very end of their entrapment. So I think that's a real big finding for us.
I think she's something of an emerging star in historical archaeology.
Go!
One of the things that I love so much about Julie, and especially enjoy working with her, is the enthusiasm.
That's way cool.
It's so infectious.
Oh, wait. Oh, my gosh. I think this is a soy sauce. It looks like right on top of this board here is a spout from a soy sauce bottle, a Chinese soy sauce bottle.
Yes.
There's no doubt what this is.
There you go.
She is really there to really help in times when your work is long, hot days and it's frustrating work. She's still like being the cheerleader.
Which, in fact, she used to be. She's always been active. The volunteer firefighting, snowboarding kind of active. And she says she's always been a tomboy. But the kind that's never been afraid to wear pink, or to poke fun at herself, or to try something new.
Oh, Susanna.
There's both the part of me that can be dressed up in feminine, but at the same time can also be a scientist who likes to play in the dirt. And I've always been true to who I am, and I've always been comfortable with being, I guess, a lipstick archaeologist, if you will.
But make no mistake, this lipstick archaeologist is not someone to be taken lightly. Julie's one of the first archaeologists in her field to discover historic period DNA from an artifact. She excavated this glass syringe from a site in Virginia City, Nevada.
Nowadays, forensics and DNA is a household word, and I wanted to understand what the syringe was used for. I wanted to know who used it. Knowing that it came from a 19th century structure just was not enough for me.
DNA tests revealed that at least four people had used the syringe to inject an opiate, most likely morphine.
There were both men and women that used that syringe, and perhaps one of those individuals was from African descent.
And I would never have been able to know that with just using traditional archaeological methods. And one thing we're not finding is there are no women's personal items, and that's because we're in a bachelor culture, really.
She's really good at interpreting history for the public. We have to share our findings with them and make it interesting, not just blasé.
This came all the way from China back in the late 19th, early 20th century, and it's either from a food storage jar or...
My goal as an archaeologist is not just to dig up the artifacts, put them in a bag, and put them in a museum somewhere, but to get that out to the public, people that have an interest in and who was here before them.
Julie Schablitsky's commitment to her science is driven by her passion to understand the past, to reconstruct history, one artifact at a time.
Even little bits and pieces from a Chinese trash pit.
This is excellent preservation.
Or DNA from a syringe can be brought together to tell a bigger story.
Oh, well, good. That's a nice complete piece.
Julie even married an archaeologist, Bob Nyland, an underwater archaeologist with the U.S. Navy.
He's water, I'm land. So he shares my passion. If you really have a drive for something, a desire, this passion that is inside of you, don't ever think, oh, I can't do it. I think it's very, very rare that people take a passion that they have and turn it into a profession. But I think it's completely possible.